Hey folks, welcome back to another episode of Throat Punch Lunch. Feels like we're kind of in the eye of the storm here because it feels kind of like convention season is over, but I know it isn't because we still have a few more conventions to go to coming up in a few weeks. But right now it's kind of like business as usual. We're back to normal a little bit, pumping out the reviews, pumping out top 10 lists and all that kind of stuff. And pumping out a Throat Punch Lunch episode. So look, man, I think I've got a pretty cool lineup of segments for you today. So let's get down to it, shall we? Let's get going.
It's Ameritrash Treasures on the Throat Punch Lunch, and I am the Undead Viking, and I just want to talk to you a little bit about an old school game called Illuminati. I recently played this at a gaming convention about a week or so ago, and I had a blast playing it. And I remember I owned a copy, and I went and dug it out, and I took a look at it again, and I played it again, and I had fun with it again. This is a game that I played a long time ago. I picked up a copy way back when Steve Jackson Games packaged all their games in these little DVD boxes, basically. Well, the DVDs didn't exist back then, but it was about the same size. And I remember playing it and having a blast with it when I was a kid. And then I remember picking this up kind of on a LARF, and because I saw there was a deluxe edition. And I never played it. And then I played it at that convention, and I brought it, and I busted it out with my friends, and we had a lot of fun. Basically because we had a lot of memories from playing it from before. Now, is it a good game? I don't know. But why don't I show you how to play, and I'll tell you why this is an Ameritrash treasure. All right, so this is Illuminati, and this is what you get if you went out and bought the game right now. Well, technically, no, because I have a couple of expansions put into these cards. But generally, this is what you're going to be getting. You're going to get a couple dice, you're going to get a bunch of cards, and you're going to get this paper money, which is absolutely awful. Look how thin that is. But regardless, it kind of has that wonderful old-school feel to it. Each person is going to control a special secret society, the Gnomes of Zurich, Bermuda Triangle, and so forth. And each one of these has a special power that's, like, listed. Illuminati group may participate in 2 attacks per turn. You know, and they also each have a special, like, way of winning. The network has to control transferable power, the second number in the power thing. If they get a certain amount, then they'll win the game. The Servants of Cthulhu need to destroy groups to win the game. The Bavarian Illuminati needs to control powerful groups, the first number, to win the game. So each person gets one of those, and then what they're going to do on their turn mostly is they're going to be trying to take control of groups. And groups are these little cards, so like here you have like Las Vegas. And so if you want to take over Las Vegas, you look at the resistance, which is 1, and then you're going to go ahead and you have to match up the arrows, so the arrows like there's an arrow going in this way, so you'd go like that to show that this controls it. You're going to control your power versus the resistance, so a 9 or less on 2 dice will win. And so here I rolled a 10 because I'm horrible and I fail, but then you'd lose that. But you can spend money to increase your chances of taking that over, and you can also convince other people to help you out. You can say, hey, help me out right here, and then I'll help you out the next turn, and so on and so forth. And people can also spend money to try to prevent you from succeeding in that as well. So they can, you know, spend money to lower the chances. But if you do control that, then on later turns what you can do is you can have kind of goofy things happen, where not only do does Las Vegas, like Bavarian Illuminati controls Las Vegas, but they then Las Vegas controls the Tri-Liberal Commission, and then when you're going to go ahead and then you'd place that there, and so then that's where the game gets to be fun, because you have kind of weird things like, okay, now here's the hackers. The Bavarian Illuminati controls the hackers, and then the hackers then are controlling the yuppies. And so you can see you have like this weird kind of connection, and then also it kind of tells a story as you play the game. Now, is this a good game? That is a really, really funny question. I remember playing this many, many times with my friends, and I remember having many, many long yelling arguments over it. But I look back on those fondly. This is definitely a game that shows its age. It kind of relies on the negotiation interaction part for the game to be continued. It is a luck box game. If you get a couple few lucky rolls, you are going to win. But it is a game about just basically influencing your friends and influencing your enemies and trying to convince them to do what you want to do. Now, you're watching Ameritrash Treasures, you're watching the Throat Punch Lunch, so this might be a game that either A, you once played and you're thinking, well, maybe I should pick that up again, or you've never heard of it and you might want to pick it up now. if you like games that are very, very confrontational, that you're not going to want to play all the time, I'd strongly suggest checking it out, because it is a lot of fun, and I like I said, I probably played this game 100 times, and even the games that were like out-and-out shouting matches, I don't think I had a bad time when I played it. But there you go. That's Illuminati. Thank you very much for watching. You have yourself one heck of an awesome day. Bye-bye.
Hey everybody, sorry that I missed a few weeks. We were busy with Gen Con and other things, didn't get a chance to record, but I'm back with Awesome Sauce, my strategy sessions here, and today I'm going to talk about Scythe. This is a game that's very popular lately. I really enjoy it, and there's a lot of different strategies in the game. Because there's so many different things you can do, you have choices on which things you want to work on the most. Is it going to be upgrades and getting your cubes from the top to the bottom? Is it going to be getting your mechs on the board to get the cool powers from the mechs? Is it going to be leeching off everyone else by bringing out the circle pieces? Or is it going to be using all your buildings? So you have tough choices in the game, and each race is slightly different. I think for the tunneling race, the black power, you want to try to get your mechs out quickly, because they will tunnel, they will get on the board, they could obviously use multiple attacks and get points in that way, so it's a very powerful strategy. For the blue ones, those are the water ones, you want to get your sea stuff out quickly so you can go through the sea spaces, which gets you all around the board. For the, I think it's the red ones, have the power where you could go in the same space more than once. When you go in that same space more than once, you want to make sure to take certain things. So, this one gets me upgrades quickly. I'm going to upgrade, and just use the same effect multiple times to burn through the powers. And it's cool because every race is slightly different than this, and the asymmetrical races lead to different strategies for each one, and each one is very, very cool, and it's unique, and definitely a game worth trying multiple times, because you could shuffle the races, you could shuffle how the upgrades work on each card, so you get a wide variety of things in Scythe.
Hi everybody, Kat Jackson here with the hobby segment of Throat Punch Lunch, and I've got some fun information to share with you today, expanding on my series of information about your tools. I'm going to talk today about the brushes that I most commonly use here at CK Studios. These are both brushes that can be used on a professional level, are an excellent investment into your tools as you expand on your hobby and experience, and they're also great for using as a new hobbyist that you may want to get a better result so you're not struggling as much with your tools. So I'm going to go over four different types or brands of brushes that I most commonly use in the studio, both for just my general hobby and also for more professional works. One of the first ones I'm going to share with you is the Winsor Newton Series 7 Kalinske Sable brushes. And it's important to note that all the brushes I'm going to share with you today are natural hair brushes. They're all Kalinske Sable brushes. None of these are synthetic or plastic. The reason why is we're painting on plastic in general. We're either painting on plastic type materials or we're painting on metals, which tend to be really hard on the tips of our brushes. So if you're already using a synthetic plastic tip brush, it tends to fray them out rather quickly in comparison to the breakdown pattern of a natural hair brush. They don't fray out as quickly. So over time, you're investing less money to take care of a good sable brush than you are a synthetic or a plastic tip brush. So again, Series 7 Winsor Newton is one of my top bets. I use those quite frequently. I like the size of the handle and the grip on them. The Rosemary Series 33 brush is a brush that I get from Monkey Sword Games, a US-based online gaming resource company. The Rosemary's have a little bit thinner of a belly than the Winsor Newton's, so I use them in different situations. Another of the brushes that I really commonly use are going to be my Raphael 8404s, something that you can order online through Amazon, like the Winsor Newton's. I also get those online through Amazon. It takes a couple weeks to get them. Generally, most of them are shipped out of the UK. The next brush that I use, and one of my absolute favorites, are the Broken Toad brushes. They're going to be my only light-colored handled brush in my arsenal. Broken-toed Brushes are a company that are based out of the UK. You can order them directly online through their website. I like these so much that they're generally the ones that, as we're giving seminars or classes, we will use these as our brush classes for our students in some of our more private settings where we do maybe 10, 12 different students. The Broken Toads are, the company is absolutely fabulous to work with, and they tend to get here very quickly, especially considering they're coming out of the UK. Something I want to talk to you about with the brush is we have our handle, we have our ferrule, we have the belly of our brush, we have the tip, or what's called the toe of the brush. The heel of the brush is going to be the part of the brush that the bristles actually meet the ferrule and keep everything kind of in place. Handle of the brush is going to be important to you in what you're comfortable with and how it grips for you. All of these brushes are going to have a little bit different of a belly size, or the size that actually the width or the density of the bristles themselves. Each will vary in brand, and so they all have their own uses and purposes in my arsenal. We want to take care of our brushes so that we're not getting debris, things clogged into the ferrule of our brush, because that tends to splay the bristles out in our brush and has a different result in our painting when our bristles are going woo. So we want to make sure that we're taking care of the brush and using a good conditioning brush soap. I love the Broken Toad products. This is the one that I use. I'll rinse my brush out really well, get all the debris out of the bristles, make sure that the ferrule's cleared, and I will reformat the tip of my brush using the conditioning brush soap so that I have a nice pointy tip at the end. And then I always keep all of my brushes with the hoods that they come in, these plastic tips that they come in, so that they're not getting damaged or destroyed during storage or traveling that way too. So the size of the brushes that we most commonly use are going to be a double aught or a 00, a 0, a 1, and a 2 in the hobby industry. I almost only use a number 1 and a number 2, but I've become comfortable using that. I like to be able to have a lot of paint in my bristles, in the belly of my brush, so I don't have to keep going back and getting more and more paint all the time. So you'll learn to use different sizes. I think hobbyists tend to start on the smaller range of sizes, and that actually is the 00 size and the 0, and then as you go up, a number 2 is probably the largest that you'll get into. So again, I hope this was useful information for you. I hope that you're increasing your fun times with your hobby, and I'd love to hear some feedback from you about brushes. If you have any questions at all, give me some feedback or contact me directly. I always enjoy helping. Kat Jackson here with the hobby segment of Throat Punch Lunch, and as we say at CK Studios, come paint with us.
Zielinski, and welcome back to Throw Punch Lunch. Hey, a lot of people ask me, Mark, what does ASLSK fan stand for? Well, it stands for Advanced Squad Leader Starter Kit Fan. And yes, I am a big fan of this game, and so I thought I would do a short video here for you to kind of talk about the game a little bit, give you a sense for it, and see if it's something that you might be interested in. All right, folks, the Advanced Squad Leader Starter Kit is basically full ASL with a lot of the chrome stripped out of it, you know, maybe 80%, maybe even more than that. You know, snipers aren't in here and advancing around the outside of hexes and things like that, and bypass movement, which are things you don't even understand. See, so you'll never miss them. So basically, ASL is played in different types of phases. So the first one is the rally phase, and that's where you're going to rally your broken troops. Then you're going to have your prep fire phase, and that's when the attacking player is going to go ahead and fire his units. Then you're going to have the movement phase, where people are going to move. Then you are going to have the defensive fire phase, and that's where the defensive player can interact in that other player's turn. Then you're going to have the advancing fire phase, and that's where people that have moved can then fire. Then you're going to have the rout phase, where if anybody is broken from combat and they're forced to rout away based on the rules, we'll then move out of combat. Then you're going to have the advance phase, and that's where any of the attacking player's units can move one space forward. And then you have close combat phase. After the attacker has run through their turn, then it's the defensive player's turn. So, and if you notice over here, this is a chart-driven game for combat. So based on the different firepower factors and stuff like that. So I'm going to go ahead and throw up a little picture of what the counters are all about here while I'm talking. And hopefully that'll give you a sense for, you know, what are the different statistics and things like that for a counter. Now you're like, Mark, show us what this is all about. So basically what we're going to do is I've got a couple of American units here in green, and I've got the German units that are here in this blue color. The Americans right now are sitting inside some stone buildings, and the Germans are sitting in a stone building, and I've got some, we'll put those guys in the woods right there just to show you a little bit about combat. So this very first number on the chits right here, that is their firepower. The second one is the range for the different units, and the last one's morale, but we're not going to deal with that for right now. Now, as you can tell, the leader counter right here only has their morale and their modifier for the different functions that a leader has. This is a 9-2 leader, so he is very, very powerful. All right, so basic fire combat, you're going to add up the different firepower. So we've got 6 firepower here, and let's say he's going to fire here in this hex, so 1, 2, 3, he's well within range. Woods right here is a +1 modifier, so you just roll the dice. I got a 9. You'd index the 6 chart, so you have the 9 + 1 = 10, and you'd see the dash right here, so that means that they missed. All right, now if you have 2 squads in the same hex, you would add their firepower. So now we have 12 firepower. If we roll the dice again, we get doubles, which actually means that the unit is going to cower. And so it would go down 1 chart, but let's just assume that it's fine for right now. So we've got 12 with the 8 + 1. Okay, so that's going to be 9 on the 12. And you get an NMC. So that's a normal morale check. All right, what that means is that the unit over here is going to roll the dice against their morale. In this case, it's a 7. I rolled an 8, so this particular unit would break. Now, if you had a unit that had a leader with it, the leader stops you from cowering, which is a big advantage. So now I've got 12 minus 2 for this, +1 for the woods. So basically at a -1, roll the dice. Oh, look at that. Got a 3. -1 is a 2. And yeah, that's the result you want right there. A 1 KIA. And that means that one unit is completely wiped off the board and you're all set. So that's basically fire combat. For movement, each of the units have 4 movement factors. Unless you have a leader, he has 6 movement factors. And then each of these different areas right here cost different movement. So a clear space is 1, so that'd be 1. Stone buildings are 2, so 2, 3. Okay. This is a very simple, very intuitive game. And I think that it is something that you should definitely check out. Again, folks, I cannot go over this entire game in the short amount of time here on Throat Punch Lunch. However, I hope I gave you a little overview and you get an idea of what this is all about. And like I said, for a $25 retail price, you can pick this up on Cool Stuff at a discount. Next time you have a game order, if you have any type of interest whatsoever in tactical World War II combat, I would highly recommend that you pick up this game. Now, thanks for joining me today. And until next time, and when we pick up another game, take care.
Hey everyone, I'm the Board Game Renegade, and welcome to my new segment. As you can already tell by the title, this new segment is all about theme in games. Now, theme is very important in Ameritrash games, and that's what they're known for, but theme is also very important for me. Sure, I could play abstract games and games with no theme at all that have good playing mechanisms. That works fine for me. But nothing captivates me more than a game with a compelling story, a nice tight theme, something where I could escape reality and just be engrossed in the game for a while. And that is why I love theme in games. Now, the game that got me to love theme in games is a game that I acquired in the early 90s. I went to Toys R Us with my uncle and he said, pick out a board game. And it was one that caught my attention and I played it and I was like, boy, I love it. And that game is HeroQuest. And it says it right here, high adventure in a world of magic. That is what caught my eye, and that is what had me getting this game. Let me show you a little bit about the theme of the game, and then we'll finish up. In HeroQuest, the evil sorcerer Zorgon returns with his sinister dark forces. And to rid the world of Zorgon's evil forces once and for all, four valiant heroes are called upon. The strong barbarian, the brave dwarf, the acrobatic elf, and the wise wizard. The heroes must embark on multiple quests in dark dungeons and treacherous keeps to defeat Zorgon's evil forces and finally put an end to the evil that taints the land. Saving the day will prove a difficult task because our four chosen warriors will be encountering goblins, orcs, furmers, zombies, skeletons, mummies, chaos warriors, and the infamous gargoyle. Lucky for us, these four warriors are very skilled. The barbarian plows down enemies with his fighting skills and use of heavy weaponry. The dwarf is no slouch in combat, and he has the skill to disable traps. The elf uses a combination of fighting skill and spells to take out his enemies. The wizard may be weak in combat, but what he lacks in combat, he makes up in magic ability. As the brave heroes explore the dark dungeons, defeating Zorgon's forces, they also find treasures and artifacts. And between each quest, the brave heroes can spend the loot that they find to buy upgrades and armor and make themselves more powerful to defeat Zorgon.
Yay, we defeated Zorgon!
We certainly did. Now, could you help me up these steps with this treasure chest?
Certainly!
Well, I hope you all like the new segment, and I'd like to hear from you. What is the first game that captured you with its theme? You could just put it down in the comments, I'd like to know. Anyway, folks, I'm the Board Game Renegade, and until next time, peace out.
Hey folks, welcome back to another segment of The Canvas, where we are taking a look at how gaming and all of the peripherals inside of gaming are affecting people's lives all around the world in a positive way. Today we're taking a look at a gentleman by the name of Tadeo Montalvo from Bullhead City, Arizona, and let's take a look at his story.
By his own admission, Tadeo has been a gamer all his life, starting largely with the Atari 2600. And at 14, he had his first introduction to RPGs and wargaming with Warhammer 40K, and during his 20s, he fell in love with Axis and Allies. Blood Bowl, Space Hulk, and Battle Fleet Gothic followed, but soon his group members moved out of the area, so he had to go back to video games like EverQuest and World of Warcraft to occupy his spare time. Now, he and his wife love to play games like Seven Wonders Duel, Patchwork, and Fuse, with family favorites being games like Blood Rage, Pandemic, and Zombicide. But he loves to sit down on his days off when the kids are at school and the wife is working and just work on a mini or two to relieve stress and just relax. He says he cranks up some music, usually something akin to the theme of what he's painting, and just zones the world out. So what started decades ago as painting just as fast as he possibly can to get a mini to the table because he saw it as a chore has become a personal passion and a stress reliever to treat himself to. It's more about the quality of time that he has with the miniatures and not the quantity of work that he can put out.
So thank you, Tadeo, for sharing with us how gaming has enriched your life in some way. I think it's really cool that you have found that not only is gaming good for couples, not only is gaming good for families, good quality family time, but gaming is also good for just chilling out, relieving that stress, and just having that very therapeutic effect that painting miniatures can have. I'm glad you found that, and I hope other people too. Now, as far as you other people out there, Still looking for people to who are willing to showcase their work and how gaming has affected their life positively in some way, shape, or form. So if you are at all interested and would like to just talk about it, email me at this email address right here, and I will do my best to keep in contact with you as best I can and explain how everything works. Until then, though, we'll see you on the flip side.
What's going on? It's Roy Cannaday from Epic Gaming Night, and this is Roll with the Punches. This week we're going to continue to look at combat mechanics in games. We're going to be looking at custom dice, where you have attack dice and defense dice, and you're rolling those off against each other to see which side takes damage. So let's look at a couple games that have those mechanics. For combat in X-Wing, players will be rolling custom dice for attack and for defense. Each ship will have different attack values and evade values that will show the number of dice you get to roll in attacking and defending. For attacking, you're going to be trying to get burst symbols that show that you've succeeded in attacks. And then for defending, you're trying to get evade symbols to show that you've successfully blocked those attacks. You compare the attacks and the evades to see if damage is actually dealt. There's also critical hit damage, that if that gets through, then they'll have to get a face-up damage card. There are several ways to mitigate and change reroll dice that you can take actions in the game to help your odds in combat. Similarly, Mice and Mystics has custom dice with attack symbols and defense symbols on them, and the characters will show how many of those dice they also get to roll. But there's only one set with different symbols on different sides. So you'll roll the dice and try to succeed more hits than they get defenses to do damage. There's several different ways you can mitigate. You can spin cheese to try to like change up dice or make it so you roll more dice than the defender and different things like that, so you can mitigate your luck in this game as well. There's a plethora of games that use very similar attack and defense custom dice mechanics. Descent and Imperial Assault, then there's Heroescape, and then also even the upcoming Rune Wars miniatures game from Fantasy Flight is going to use these attacking with the attacker with custom dice and then defense dice as well. So those are several different games that use the attack and defense dice with the custom dice mechanic. I always think it's super interesting. I hate in these games when you roll a whole bunch of attack dice and get a whole bunch of hits, and then your opponent like rolls exactly what they need to evade or block all of the damage that you've done. But that's just part of these games, about figuring out how to use target locks and things like that in X-Wing to manipulate those, or use some of the cool little abilities you get in Mice and Mystics to alter how many dice you get to roll or what dice they're rolling for defense to try to swing the odds into your favor for these games. There's lots of ways to mitigate stuff with the team building in X-Wing and try to make it so that you can spin luck in the way that it's going to help you out the most. But it really just, it's you're rolling dice, so it's going to go back and forth, so hopefully luck will be on your side. Let me know what your favorite combat mechanic is, if you like these dice games where you're rolling back and forth and seeing which side wins, or if there's other mechanics in combat that you like even better. So let me know in the comments down below what your favorites are, and this has been Roll with the Punches, and we'll see you guys next time.
Hi guys, it's Breach18 and we're here at the Dice Cup in Nottingham, and I am joined by the lovely Ben and Mark from Aircon.
Hello.
Hi.
And they are here to talk to us all about Aircon.
Aircon.
Yeah.
So, go for it. Here's your time to shine.
Great. Well, we started Aircon, it's about a year ago now, just over a year ago, and it actually started in my house.
Right, okay.
That was our first one, and it was really just an opportunity to get some people together and play some games and do some other fun stuff. Like even in my house, we were watching like board game related films and like doing a game design competition and stuff.
Okay.
We got about 30 people in
your house.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. That must be a pretty big house.
Yeah, well, so we've got a pretty big living room. We have three tables set up and lots of games going on. It was fun.
Okay.
And I suppose we wanted to just keep that atmosphere as we've grown as well, so
yeah.
We're about to do our third event in October. So,
right, yeah. And that's in Bradford.
Yep.
And so when's that in the time in terms of in the year? So is that?
So that's going to be happening on the 21st and 22nd of October this year.
Okay, yeah. And how can people get to that? Do they have to buy tickets in advance?
Or? Yeah, it's probably best to buy tickets in advance. We sold out our last event in April, and it's looking like we'll probably sell out again. It's actually the weekend after Essen, so if people can't get to Essen, we're going to have a bunch of Essen releases there.
Yeah. Oh, wow, that's really
along
cool.
And we have a massive board game library, about 350 games probably. So.
Oh, wicked. Okay, and so what can people expect to find there? Is it going to be a very similar setup to the UK Game Expo, or is it going to be completely different? Is it more focusing on games, retail?
Yeah, it's a lot more focused on the open gaming.
Right,
you know,
okay.
We're going to have traders there, and we're going to have a few events going on, but it's really all about the open gaming.
Okay.
We just love kind of getting people together, and like, you know, when you sit around over a game with strangers, you can instantly make friends and you've got something in common.
Yeah, definitely.
So that's the kind of feel we try and keep. And
awesome. And how much does that cost?
So it's £8.50 for a day, or you can get both days for £15.
Okay, excellent. Right, so talking about cons then.
Yeah.
Obviously, we've just had Gen Con.
Sure.
Although this is Café Chat, the segment, we tend to focus on Amerithrash games.
Yeah.
So have you seen anything Amerithrash theme that's come out of Gen Con that has sort of taken your eye?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if Seafall counts. I mean, we're super excited for that. It's maybe not too much.
Seafall's like a legacy game, heard. And it's got this huge prologue.
Yeah.
Because obviously no one, unlike Pandemic, not many people will know how to play it. So there's this whole prologue game, but I think it lasts like 2 hours or something crazy like that before you can actually get into it.
Yeah.
But it does look fantastic. So definitely.
Who else came out? Mystic Veil. I don't know if that counts as Ameritrash, really.
I would describe that as a very pasted on theme.
Yeah, definitely.
To be fair, it's one of the games that caught my eye, and subsequently I've actually purchased it.
I've yet
to play it, but I have purchased it.
I've played it a couple of times.
It's definitely a novelty thing, I think.
Yeah, yeah. I think it needs an expansion pretty quickly.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So what would you like to see in the expansion?
Just more stuff, really. Most deck builders are just like a ton of stuff to pick from, but this is quite limited, I think, in the base game. The Flick 'em Up Dead of Winter. That looks epic.
Oh, that does look really,
it's so
really
much fun.
Good.
Yeah, we had a big game of Flick 'em Up back in April at the last AirCon, actually, and it was pretty mega. And so just to get the Dead of Winter theme on.
Yeah,
really,
I mean, John Gilmore, the creator, one of the co-creators of Dead of Winter, is a friend of mine, and he kept that pretty quiet. So I will be getting back on it, John, as to why he didn't tell me about that. That would have been a nice scoop.
Yeah.
So other than those games, then, anything else?
The only other game that caught my eye was Cry Havoc, that kind of area control game.
That's
like
one.
Really, really, really exciting.
It looks really good, doesn't it?
Yeah,
it looks definitely
bright.
I think it's probably more of a hybrid.
Yeah.
But definitely, that's one that just the box art looks stunning.
So
I think you're pretty similar to me as to what things that I found really exciting about Gen Con.
Definitely. And I think one of the surprises was at Clank. I think that sounds pretty cool. So that's like a deck builder thing with this kind of weird clank mechanism in it.
It sounds familiar, really, but I haven't actually seen
it.
So
it's like, I think it was one of the surprise hits of Gen Con.
Oh, right, okay, that'll be one. See if I can get some pictures and put them up on the video. Well, thank you guys for joining me.
Cheers.
It's been great talking to you, and thank you for making the journey up from Bradford, because obviously it's not just next door, it's quite a haul. So I do appreciate that, and look forward to seeing you both at AirCon,
because
I will be going.
Great.
So, you don't have to pay me £500, but we won't talk about that. We're not going to talk about that. Thank you. And thank you guys for watching, and enjoy the rest of your lunch.
Throat Punchies, I'm Forrest from Bowers Game Corner, and I'm back again for three reasons. And this week, once again, I'm going to be doing a special Gen Con episode. I went to Gen Con, I shot over 150 interviews about new and upcoming games, and so this week I'm going to be talking to you about three upcoming games, hopefully in the not-too-distant future, that I absolutely think you should have on your radar. The first game is Latitude 90 Degrees, The Origin from Ghost Roadhouse. It's currently on Kickstarter. It is a large group social deduction game for 8 to 24 players, like Werewolf, Mafia, Two Rooms and a Boom, Witch Hunt, etc., etc. Except this one is actually done entirely on your phone or tablet. So everybody's going to be using their device, keeping track of all the information that they have in the game. So the theme is essentially John Carpenter's The Thing. So you're a bunch of researchers, a couple of you are infected, and they're trying to spread that infection. But the kicker with this game is it only lasts 10 minutes. No one is eliminated. There is no moderator because the computer brain in your phone does all of that stuff. And yet you still are just incredibly involved. You're not just staring at your phone. You're actually talking with one another. I got a chance to play this twice. It was a little bit daunting to figure out, but once I got my legs underneath me, this is an incredibly promising game. I played the bare bones version of the game. I can't wait to see it with different roles implemented. Definitely one you might want to check out if you like large group social deduction games. The next game I want to talk about is When I Dream from Draw Lab Entertainment. This is for 4 to 10 players, and hopefully it will be coming out at Essen. This is a deduction, storytelling, hidden role game with absolutely gorgeous artwork, where one person per round is going to be covering their eyes. They're going to have something that's going to cover their eyes, and then they're going to try and figure out what their dream is. Their dream is going to be a card that is flipped up in the center of the table. Everyone else around the table is going to be able to give one-word clues to try and help the dreamer figure out what their dream is, but it's not that simple because there's hidden roles. So some people want the dreamer to succeed, some people want the dreamer to fail, but at the same time, you don't want to be so blatantly obvious. You want to kind of just string them along a la Spyfall. It looks like an incredibly promising game. It looks like it has some really cool mechanisms going on in here. That's When I Dream from Draw Lab Entertainment. The final game I want to talk about is Fallen Land from Fallen Dominion Studios. This is for 2 to 5 players. It's currently on Kickstarter right now, and this is a post-apocalyptic sandbox game, a meaty one at that, as it will be about 1 hour per player. But this game looks incredible. I did over 150 interviews at Gen Con, and this was the one that floored me the most. So essentially, you are going to have your town, and you're going to be exploring around America and trying to upgrade your town. There are 10 asymmetrical towns you'll be able to play as. There are 80 unique characters that will have their own different abilities to play as. There are 140 encounter cards and 40 mission cards in this game. Now, that doesn't sound impressive. You know, most of them are like, you'd think like, most are like, hey, it's starting to rain. Get -2 on your movement die. No, these cards have stories on them. 1 or 2 paragraphs on a card immersing you, smothering you, covering you in delicious theme in this game, and that's what attracted me to this game. Also, it has technology upgrades, it has roaming NPCs that you can hire. It looks like an absolutely amazing game that could be a masterpiece, or it could be a train wreck, but I'm hoping it's a masterpiece. That's Fallen Land from Fallen Dominion Studios. This has been 3 reasons, and if you enjoy me mixing it up on this segment with different topics, let me know in the comments below, and also give me some more ideas that you would like to see in the comments below. And as always, back to more throat punchy goodness.
Hey everyone, this is Tim Jeanette the Metal Meeple, and this is the Miniature Breakdown. So finally, for the factions, we're going to take a look at the Retribution of Syrah, and the Mercenaries, which have kind of inner factions as well. So I don't have any models for Retribution, so enjoy these pictures, but basically they're kind of like an alien race. They have a lot of advanced technologies. They were separated themselves from society, basically, and came about later on. But anyway, not really going into the storyline of them, they do have some really cool stuff. They've got a lot of your traditional units, which are called like Dawn Guards and the House Guards, and basically they kind of fulfill the roles of what your other units for other factions would do. You know, that I've got this one role, I'm ranged combat, or I've got really defensive capabilities, things like that. But they also have a lot of mages that are very fragile. They're easily taken care of if you're not careful, but they can pull off some crazy good stuff. You know, basically they're assassins and things like that. So they can end the game or at least turn the tide of battle really fast. One house of their warjacks are called Myrmidons, they basically have force fields. So when they take damage, damage is applied to the force field before it goes to their damage grid. And this is important because even if you get alpha strike by a bunch of models taking damage on that one warjack, it can possibly still have all its systems intact to retaliate. Anyway, some of my favorite models in this are like the Mage Hunter Assassins. They are pretty much, they have a huge melee range during the their activation because they get this massive whip. They run up, and so when it's not their turn, they don't have that threat range, but they're really cool. They're just kind of very assassin-y. I guess you can tell that I like rogues and assassins pretty well. They have the Mage Hunter of Infiltrators, which are the same thing. They're basically like rogue ninja, kind of sneaky. They've got stealth. They're really hard to shoot, obviously. We've got the Thyrin, the Sword of Truth. Just because this model is awesome, and I don't really plan on playing Retribution, but I plan on picking him up just to paint him. Anyway, let's move on to the mercenaries, though, because I have lots to show you. Mercenaries, like I said, you can form contracts, and these contracts will allow you to basically play a whole band of mercenaries, or they can be combined into other factions, you know, one guy at a time, or units and things like that. So I just want to go over some of my favorites that I use. One is going to be Ashlyn Dees. Basically, she's like the Joan of Arc in a way, and she's just really fast. She can hit things a lot on her turn with her swords. She's got some cool, cool spells. I really like this model, and I like what she can do. Second, we have Iris, which is pretty much a staple in War Machine. A lot of people used her, at least in MK2 and MK1. She's like the assassin. I mean, it's really easy to pull off, or well, not easy, but it makes your life a lot better if you have her in your team to go after caster assassinations to only, you know, go after the enemy warcaster. We have Rupert. He is really cool. He's like a bard. You run him around with some of your units, and it makes him just a couple different buffs he can choose from each turn. Really, really fun. Gorman DeWolf, I have not painted, but he's basically a rogue alchemist, runs around throwing bombs everywhere. And finally, the Nyss Hunters, because they are basically extremely hard to hit. Once they get hit, they do die. They get taken out by AoE is really easy, but they're really cool and really fun to play. Anyway, if you have any questions, feel free to comment or send me an email or whatever on the social media below. And until next time, keep on rocking and rolling dice.
Hey again, everyone. Georgie here, and I'm back with the past. And this time I've chosen the two-player game, Kahuna, designed by Gunter Kernet.
Okay, so when you get the game board out, you realize that the game board is really, really nice, and you can see there's a little path joining all the islands together. This is an area control game where you guys play wizards battling over control of the land, and whoever has the most land gets the most points, and that's how you win. The next thing you're going to do is decide which color you're going to be, black or white. You'll take all the corresponding bridges and palm tokens. Then each player will get dealt three cards. These cards have island names on them. And that's how you build your bridges as such. Shuffle the remaining deck and deal three face up and put the rest as a draw pile. The face up cards and draw pile are very important because on your turn you can play one to as many cards as you like from your hand and draw a card from either one of the face up cards or one from the draw pile. With the main aim being to take control of islands, the cards help you do just that. The card has an island name on it, and you can place a bridge of your colour going in any direction off that island. The bridges are what helps you take control of the islands. Now, whenever you have over half the amount of routes to that island conquered by your colour, that means you take control of that island. And you continue to do this back and forth, and it becomes quite take that. And then the player at the end of the first round with the most islands gets 1 point, end of the second round with the most islands gets 2 points, and the end of the third round you count your islands and whoever has the most points at the end is the winner.
So guys, that's Kahuna, a fun, entertaining two-player game that I really, really enjoy. I'll be back next time with The Present.
Welcome to Miniatures World. Now, as you know, Sam, see, this is Cat, Tim. Now, this week I was supposed to mold some miniatures, but we're going to skip that. Because you want to know what? What's the best part of Gen Con, guys?
The miniatures!
Did you just say Euro
games? Euro games?
Do you even paint, bro?
I think it's the trainer.
Hey, wait a minute. What are you even doing here anyways?
What? You're not on Throw Punch Lunch.
I thought we'll just have a lunch, guys.
Get out of here. What's wrong with you?
Let's go around and check out all the miniature here.
We're getting blunder, man. We're getting blunder.
Get out.
Let's go check out some miniatures here at Gen Con.
So that is it for Throat Punch Lunch, Episode 5. And we are back to normal. I know I was missing a couple of contributors, but they have assured me that they will be back next episode. So please, please come back next time. I want to thank you so much for joining us this time. I certainly hope you enjoy all of the segments. I know you're probably not going to enjoy all of them, but more the merrier, right? Well, hey, thank you for joining us, and as always, we'll see you on the flip side. Take care.
Thanks so much for watching the Dice Tower videos. Find more great videos and reviews, as well as our top-rated audio podcast at Dicetower.com. You can also find other great shows at Dicetowernetwork.com. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching the Dice Tower. The Dice Tower is sponsored by Cool Stuff, Inc., where you can find great games for great prices. Cool stuff in stock. Check them out at CoolStuffInc.com.